Hello and welcome to this week's edition of Twa Teams One Street. I'm Tom Duthie and podcasting alongside me in the flesh again is George Cran.
Hello.
Alan Temple.
Morning.
And Graeme Finnan.
Hello everyone.
Suppose we should start this week by apologising for the absence of the podcast last week. It was recorded.
Oh, it was good stuff as well.
It was the best ever stuff. Apart from the bit I forgot.
Greatest ever episode.
But I think we were hacked by the Russians. Or another foreign power. Other foreign powers are available. No, apparently.
Maybe it was another podcast.
They can't handle your truth, Tam, if you've been shut down.
That's a word I've never heard corrected to my name before. Truth. But hopefully this week the recording will last till their time. And don't forget, as they keep asking me, but I forget, you can also watch us on YouTube.
Whee! If this week's is released, that is.
You can watch a blank screen on YouTube, come what may. And hopefully you'll be able to listen as well. Anyway, down to business, chaps. And the business this weekend, sorry my fellow Dundee fans, for me it's all at Tannadice when United meet Raith Rovers.
Yeah, United Rovers, the final chapter, and the biggest of the quartet by some distance. It's a huge game, only made bigger by yet more drop points at the weekend for Dundee United. And after two defeats and a draw against Raith Rovers this season, albeit every game has been very, very tight, and United were probably marginally the better team in the last match at Starks Park, that all counts for nothing. They need to beat their biggest rivals and are now in such a position that unless they win the match, then the title, with a handful of games left, will be in Raith Rovers' hands, which is a prospect that isn't worth thinking about if you're a Dundee United fan.
You
and one that's
thought about earlier in the season.
You've got everyone panicking now, Alan, I've got to say.
Well,
but you're absolutely spot on, yeah.
That's the reality of the situation. I mean, I don't think I've even expressed an opinion at this point. That is just the facts. And
facts can be scary, you know.
And in terms of the opinion of the matter, it's now time for United to show us the team that they were for periods in the first half of the season that they haven't been in 2024. I mean, 6 wins from 13 games is not good enough for this calendar year, and they're wobbling and stumbling towards the title, but there is still enough time to build some momentum and to get over the line. But they need to show gumption and determination and tempo and hell, a bit of anger, a bit of frustration, you know, properly go for this, because not only are Raith Rovers still on their tail, not only are Raith Rovers threatening to win this league, but Raith Rovers have been ripping the pee all season in terms of their interactions with Dundee United to an extent. So if this isn't a fired up, attacking, determined United team on Saturday, then I don't know what will ever be.
Aye, it's a big game. It strikes me, Baird, the one thing in Jim Goodwin's favour this week is his team talk. He can actually, with justification, say to his players, play like you did at Starks Park last time you met them, and you should win, because it was a game that was there for them to win. But they've got to, A, play like that, and B, when they create opportunities, take them.
Absolutely, absolutely. And it's, you know, it'll be an easy team talk for Jim Goodwin. I think it'll be a more difficult team selection after last week's performance, Tom, against Inverness. And I've got to must admit, if I were a Dundee United fan, I'd be starting to get a wee bit worried after last week's show against Inverness. But I saw the game, and you know, we've spoken in the past about how United they have been a bit laboured at Tannadice, but they've always tried to play a bit of football and get down the sides. What I saw last week was a game where they basically, certainly in the second half, they reverted to launching long balls in the Inverness box and hoping to win second balls. Now, that nearly worked a couple of times for goals, but if you're going down that route for your last half a dozen games or so, I think they all start to become pretty much in the melting pot about how things are going to drop. I spoke last week about a couple of things about, a couple of weeks ago, about Glenn Middleton, how important he was for Dundee United. And I think, you know, last week must have surely been his worst game in a Tangerine jersey, right from his first touch. I think it was a free kick which he overhit. He couldn't either. He was either overhitting passes or he was, you know, hitting the first man with free kicks. And United just struggled. And United need Glenn Middleton performing. And that's a real concern for me. You know, they need him performing at his best to create things. And it just didn't work. And I shouldn't pin the blame solely on Glenn Miller.
I was going to challenge you slightly because he didn't have his best game. But like you say, they were pumping the ball down.
Yeah.
Give him the ball.
Yeah.
Give the laddie the ball.
I think that's right. And it might just be one of those games where nothing was really, really coming off him. But I think, Tom, when somebody's doing that, that's why you revert to long balls. If it's not happening, if you're giving the ball to the wide areas and for one reason or another, it's not being delivered into the box, then what happens is you start throwing in balls from deep. I think the one shining light for Dundee United last week was Ross Docherty in the middle of the park, who kept trying to do good things on the ball, who kept trying to drive his team on. On another day, he could have got the goal that could have won them the game.
He was very good going forward.
Trying to inspire his players, and that's what they're going to need on Saturday against a Raith Rovers side, who I still think they'll be sort of struggling to believe they're still in this title race, you know, the way United's kicked on, and Raith have had their struggles as well. But Alan's right, it's coming down to this one game. And at 5 o'clock on Saturday night, you know, you certainly don't want to be on the wrong side of the result, either team, because you know, regardless of what you do in your final few games, the other team can still win the title by what they do. So, yeah, it's a massive game for both clubs.
Yeah, George, they've both been better before Christmas than after Christmas, but is the difference that Raith Rovers are delighted to be where they are? Because if you looked at the start of the season, the talk of the championship was Dundee United and who might be their challengers. Mm. Raith were not top of that list of likely challengers. For the life of me, I can't remember who is. Probably likes at Inverness in there. But I mean, Raith were the mid-table team last season.
Yeah, they were a fairly new team over the summer as well. They brought in some good signings that I think people were really interested to see how they did, and they've worked out really well, I think. But in terms of the form of both teams, I was just having a look at, actually a bit surprised at how good Raith's recent form is since they beat United. Mm-hmm. They've won four games. They haven't conceded in the last three.
Yeah.
They're recovering from their bad start to the
game. And that's four clean sheets in the last five. The other one being that game at Arbroath. So they are coming into this game with a bit of form. I think in terms of being happy to be in the title, is that. Yeah, I can see that. I think there's more pressure on United just because it's Dundee United in the Championship. We've talked about that plenty, but both clubs in this city, when they're in this division, the expectation is they win it and they win it well.
I hold my hands up and take responsibility for that. I predicted United would win the league by October, maybe a bit frivolous with that. But at the same time, as a follower of football in this city, and the same would go for Dundee, and it did this time last season, I'm looking at that table, and even though the United are top, part of me is saying, why aren't you further ahead? Why haven't you sewn this up? Because that's what's expected of them. Raith don't have that expectation.
Yeah, there is about that, but I'm sure every single player who signed for Dundee United knew what they were signing up for. That there is pressure playing for this club, the size of club, the size of fan base, which should be a really good atmosphere again at Tannadice on Saturday, and these players have to stand up and be counted and show they have the ability to play for Dundee United and win things with Dundee United. I think this is where the season comes down on Saturday. It doesn't decide who's going to win the league, but I think it decides who takes control of it, and it's up to United to make sure it's them.
I mean, Alan, it's not really overstating to say this is one of the biggest games in United's recent history for all sorts of reasons, because A, they want to get promoted, so there's the prestige, there's financial. Jim Goodwin, as we say, again, it's just a fact for managers of Dundee United, if they're in the Championship, you're struggling to keep your job if you don't get them up. And then the bit that we should have extensively gone over last week, but I forgot to mention it, there's talk of, and you'll keep me right with the bees, Brentford and Brighton looking at an investment. You would think that investment takes a big step closer if United are back in the Premier League. So there's all sorts of issues, not just with this game, because it doesn't decide the title, but over the next few weeks that United have to win.
Yeah, well, whether the interest is predicated on what division they're in is arguable, but I would suggest the price tag certainly is.
Yeah.
In terms of how much a shareholding would be valued in kind of empirical terms, for a championship club is very different to a premiership club, and I'm sure Brentford will be very much keeping an eye on that. I think Brighton have other irons in the fire, so I wouldn't expect them back at the Dundee United table unless that was to collapse elsewhere. But Brentford, very much one to watch as the week goes on, but you know, that is probably very much a, you know, once things have settled gradually, you can have a grown-up discussion, because very hard to do anything definitive while you don't know what division you're going to be in. And yeah, I think the important thing is, probably from a United perspective and from a Raith Rovers perspective actually, is to not actually look too much at the sort of macro picture, because I think at that point,
that's for the directors.
Yeah, exactly. I think at that point the pressure of just a single football match does become slightly suffocating, whereas you just need to be looking at it as a one-off match against a team that 11 versus 11, you would, all things being considered, be hopeful of coming out on top against, but haven't done it three times so far this season. So it's time to kind of stop the talking and just, this should be a game that United players relish. We've been told all season that these are big game players, big characters, and they are. I mean, these boys have careers that speak to that. You get guys like Jack Walton, Declan Gallagher, Ross Docherty, Craig Sibbald, Louis Moult, Tony Watt. These are guys with international caps, titles, Champions League appearances, you know, promotions down south as well. So this should be the sort of game that makes them stand up and go, do you know what, I fancy this one. Go out, pack Tannadice, here we go, this is the stage I belong at, and perform on it. It shouldn't be a case of, oh, we'll talk about nerves, we'll talk about wilting in front of the fans. It's not, it can be a wee bit overstated. There is a degree of pressure, but it wasn't toxic at the weekend. It was a wee bit, it was apathy, there was disappointment. It wasn't, you know, there isn't this bear pit of fans waiting to turn on the players. It's not really like that. It's, you know,
as part of that, they're not daft, they want promotion. So they're no turning on the team right now. Maybe if it all goes wrong, and hopefully it doesn't, but maybe then you get the anger. But right now they want the team to do well.
Every football so like every big football club kind of thinks their team is super unique, or their fandom is unique. It's not really.
No.
It's no different to when I covered Hibs, or it's less severe than when I covered Hearts. I mean, Christ, Tynecastle turns. Tannadice is fine, and it's not an excuse the players should have. It's they really get back behind the team when given any encouragement to do so. So it's just about giving them that, and even when things don't start well, or if things do get a bit nervous, this toxicity or this difficulty to play in front of a packed Tannadice, it's just, I think it can be a bit overstated sometimes, and it absolutely should not be an excuse for any of these players.
It's just the results, though, because we've talked a few times in the AZ game would probably be the last big crowd
big,
where
big
the
game,
United
yeah.
have won the big game, so that's where the conversation comes from, isn't it? Just the results. So it's time to go and put that right, I would say.
But I mean, I think Alan makes a very good point, which is not unusual, to be fair to him. But I mean, if you talk about grounds, I think Dens can be a difficult place for teams. I think Tynecastle, the minute something goes wrong, can be a difficult place. In the modern era, I tend to think Ibrox and Parkhead, when things aren't going too well, different if they're losing, but if it's 0-0 after 20-30 minutes, it tends to go quiet. And that's what you notice. The atmosphere's a bit strange, but United's one of the grounds where, doesn't matter what's happened the week before, when the players run out on that park, their fans will be getting right behind them. They just always do.
Yeah, and they can use that to their advantage on Saturday, Tam. There's going to be 10,000 plus, I think, at the game, the way people are talking. And the vast majority of those fans, which Raith Rovers won't be too happy about, will be Dundee United fans. And they can use that to their advantage. Absolutely. The fans have backed them all season, but again, what I would say is the pressure is on Dundee United, in as much as you do feel, well, they do. They have to win this game to keep the sort of, you know, the league title in their own hands. I do think there are going to be drop points beyond this time. There's no doubt about that. We've seen Raith Rovers get to the top of the table and absolutely crumble, effectively, because they were in front. You know, they didn't pick up full points. And going forward, I do expect there to be drop points. But the facts will be on Saturday night, if Dundee United don't win the game, if Raith do the business in their final six games or whatever it is, they will be champions. So that's the sort of pressure that United have to take into that game. But they have to embrace it, Tam. They have to take, you know, that they've got the 90% of the crowd will be right behind them on Saturday and pushing them on. And I'm sure they're going to back them, even if it is still 0-0 at half time. But if they see a team who is in the ascendancy, if they play the way they did, it starts part where for, you know, 70% of that game they were well on top, but they just didn't get the goal. If they could keep that going and have the fans back, and I'm sure it will get them over the line.
In fairness to United too, I'm thinking back to the start of the season, there was a nightmare of a League Cup section, and everybody was going, oh no, what's going on here? Apart from Duthie, me, I was shouting from the rafters of stupid things, but the players reacted, and when the league came around, it started like an express train. Somebody says
no,
something.
They did. You know, that's you know what?
You didn't ask a question.
It was a statement that threw open to the world.
You're absolutely right with that, but that seems like an eternity ago now. Mm.
But it's not, though. That's the truth. Only a few months ago, this team was under pressure, and it came out and reacted in exactly the right way.
Of course it did. And the vast majority of players that did that are still there. But I do think that the performances at home and some of the performances in general have got Jim Goodwin thinking now, what team do I actually put out? The guys that he's pinned a lot of faith in have maybe not quite performed to the levels they once were. It's how does he get the mix absolutely right? And when we saw on Saturday, you know, Mark Thompson at left back, that young lad has played right wing, right back, left back. Now, that's a lot to pin on a young man who's just come back from a loan spell at Montrose, I think it was. So what's going on in Jim Goodwin's head? Are Dundee United not got the squad that maybe we think they actually have? Obviously, he rates Miller Thompson very highly, and he is an attacking-type player, but surely there must be other options available to him rather than play Miller Thompson at left-back. You know, I can't try to pick the manager's team, but I wonder what's going through his head when it comes to selection. And Saturday's show against Inverness will only have given him more sort of food for thought on what sort of team he puts out against Raith Rovers.
I'll try to pick his team a wee bit. It's surely unthinkable this weekend that Louis Moult would start on the bench again.
No, I think Louis Moult's got to start. He made a real difference when he came on. I think he would be the first to say that he's missed, you know, a few chances in recent games, and there's been hits and misses in terms of performances, but that goes with pretty much everybody in that United side in 2024. So, but he's come on and scored a preposterous goal.
Yes.
A quite simply preposterous goal. And I'd maybe put him in a very, very select band of people, perhaps with along with a Tony Watt, a Dylan Easton, Louis Vaughan, and out of people in this division that are capable of scoring that goal. Just due to the technique, awareness and audacity that's required. Mm-hmm. There's very few footballers that have got a
speed of thought.
Yeah.
It wasn't a spec. I mean, he's taking a gamble that he gets it on target, but he's reacted to
and
the
goalkeeper. He's also had to leave Cammy Kerr flailing about on the deck, just shrugged him off. And that was a degree of strength before
I'm
then.
I'm just wondering now, when he's sitting on the bench in that first half, if he's watching Mark Ridgers and going, he's off his line, and he's got it in his head, and if the opportunity comes, that's really fast thinking. So to execute it the way he did was unbelievable.
We asked him that afterwards, basically said, is that something you'd spied, or you know, did you have a quick glance? He basically said, well, you know, as a player, where the goalkeeper will be when you are at any particular point on a pitch, because goalkeepers are coached as well. I don't need to tell you that.
I think Mark Ridgers was in the right place, because you've got to play as a sweeper. Yeah. You've got to play anything over the top. Yeah. You've got to be able to come that. So if you're standing way back on your goal line, it opens up a whole field of play for other players to run into. But you certainly don't expect the centre forward to do that.
So it was a moment of absolute magic, and ironically, probably the toughest chance Louis Moult's had in the previous, you know, whatever, 3-4 games, and he's popped that away. So hopefully that's a really positive thing for him, because from my view, he's the best finisher United have got. I think he's the best out-and-out number nine that United have got. And if he's on it, then everything else can kind of revolve around him because he's good at holding the ball up, he's good at scoring, he can bring people into the play. If he's at it and fully fit, then Jim Gooden got a wee bit of criticism for the fact that Moult didn't start. It's worth saying that Jim Gooden was talking, it was that Moult maybe didn't have 90 minutes in him. He was still, you know, just coming back from a slight knock. So I don't think the manager can be dragged over the coals too much for that particular decision, but he's made a big decision when he's made a big impact when he came on. He'll definitely start against Rovers.
It's one of his other great sort of values to the team that everybody can play badly. Hopefully, he plays well, but he's always involved. He won't disappear from a game if things aren't going his way.
Oh, a huge character. He's a huge character, and he'll be one of the loudest voices in the dressing room before the match, halftime, when things aren't going well. He's an important guy to have on the football pitch. If you've got Jack Walton, Declan Gallagher, Ross Docherty and Louis Moult running through the spine of that team, I feel more comfortable in terms of the characters you have on the pitch and the ability to drag yourself through the difficult moments in football matches. So providing they're all fit, I think that could be a real boost for United.
I was going to say, you tend to think these guys play every minute they're capable of playing between now and the end of the season, just because that influence they have on the team. Like I say, everyone can have a bad game from time to time, but you're talking about boys that will still influence the team, however well they're playing individually.
Definitely. Yeah, I think if you are able to get out there and put in a performance that won't make you a liability to the side, then I think you'll be strapped up and got out there. I suspect that'll be the case, for example, for Scott McMahon this week. I doubt he'll be 100%, but I suspect he'll play because the left-back situation is a right headache. If Scott McMahon's not there, because Bear was alluding to the decision to play Miller Thompson, I personally would have played Kevin Holt at left-back and brought Ross Graeme in beside Gallagher, but I get managers don't like splitting up centre-back pairings.
Kevin Holt, of course, up the road and played as a left-back.
Yeah. Exactly, he's played the majority of his career at left-back, so I thought that would have been the obvious one, but managers...
Sometimes I think he maybe regrets now because...
Perhaps. But the point, my point being, that's not even an option now. Kevin Holt will be probably...
Well, I was away to say, one of the great things about doing podcasts or journalism in general is... hypocrisy is quite acceptable.
Of course it is.
I and others, but it's up to you to put your hands up, sat at the start of the season and say, is Kevin Holt the player you would sign? Mm-hmm. Say, come the end of March, devastating loss if you ask me. And it looks like he might have played his last game of the season. I hope not.
I hope not as well.
Just the fact that they need a scan to determine how bad the knee injury is he suffered, but when you reach the middle of the week after the game, and the swelling's not going down and they can't do the scan, you tend to think it's a bad one, don't you?
Yeah, and speaking to Ross Docherty, who obviously came to United with Kev last summer, Ross Docherty pointed out that the feeling in the dressing room was a similar injury to one that he did last season, and that one kept him out for 2 months. They were hopeful that it might not actually be as bad as that one, just from what Kevin was apparently saying in the dressing room and stuff. So, however... you're not just talking about what it would take to diagnose and remedy the issue. You're then talking about getting them back up to sharpness.
Yeah.
You're then talking. I don't see all that happening in the less than 6 weeks left of the season. So I think that might be that. So Ross Graeme, and you come and grab that jersey because he was probably rightly. In fact, from what the manager said, I think you can surmise that he was definitely. Annoyed about coming out that team on a period of good form, so go in there and take that frustration out on your next seven opponents.
George, it's a player you've followed since his early days, but I was just going to say we're speaking about players that influence the team through finger pointing, saying the right things on the pitch and in the dressing room beforehand. I always think players like Holt are maybe undervalued because it's his calmness. He always looks calm, whatever the situation, and that can affect. That has a positive effect on those. When things are sort of going against you, and you look at the boy in the middle of the defence, and he's sort of sorting his hair and looking relaxed, it can you go, well, he's okay, so I'll be okay.
I think in that position, that it has an even bigger effect if you're a centre back and you're composed and the ball comes to you in a pressure situation and the attacker's closing you down and you just take a nice simple touchdown and then pass it off to somebody else. I think that does kind of breed across the team. And Kevin Holtz, he's always been a good player on the ball, I think. Mm-hmm. Coming through Korea in the South as a left back and then obviously moving to Dundee, I always rated his ability as an attacking fullback. Sometimes I think defensively at Dundee, I think he got found out sometimes. But he was learning his game at that point, and you can see how much he's learned since then, since he's come at United. I was a wee bit surprised that I think in the summer that United went from Partick, but I'm not surprised at how well he's done, I have to say.
Because he'd one of their best performers, hasn't he?
He's just a very, very, it's probably damning with faint praise, but I was going to say a very, very, very solid championship defender. But I think he's got the capability to go up to the Premiership as well. I think just a very, very solid defender who can play a bit.
I have to say, just in my humble opinion, I thought they were signing a player for a year in the Championship. Get us out of this league and that you'll get your reward. But the level of his performance at centre back, I would say he's worth the place. Still, hopefully, when they go up.
I suspect that if they, regardless of what division they're in, that Kevin Holt's probably done enough to get another year. Just partly because of his performances, but also due to the intangible stuff like his versatility, albeit they chose not to use it last weekend, that versatility and the sort of personality he is around the place. It was something that Jim Goodman spoke a lot about at the start of the season when things were going really well, was building a certain character profile within his squad. And although the conversation has now moved on to rather more pressing matters in terms of trying to win games again and get promoted, that remains a very, very important aspect of what Dundee United are trying to do. And I think Kevin Holt is, as well as the footballing virtues that he brings, I think will provide depth, versatility, and is the right sort.
I must admit, this is no reflection on Ross Graeme whatsoever, because he's an excellent prospect, but I look at the Gallagher-Holt partnership, and that's a big blow for me.
Absolutely.
Because they look like, in terms of character, personality, styles, reading of the game, they look like the perfect centre defensive partnership.
There's a nice balance there, wasn't there? And that's going to be a loss for United. George is right about what I like about Kevin Holt is, having played a lot of his career at left back, where you do have to link up a bit more on the ball than centre halves do, he's taken that into his centre half. So when he gets the ball, he doesn't just look, he can put his foot through it when he's got it and when he wants to. But in general, his head's up. He's looking to get Ross Graeme and Ross Docherty and Craig Sybold on the ball with nice passes, and he can pass the ball as well. So it is a big loss for Dundee United. And the concern is now they've still got six games to go here, maybe more, you know, depending on the way things pan out. Heaven forbid something happens to one of the two centre halves that are in there. We've got the lad that came in from St Johnstone, Alan. What was
Sam McClelland? Yeah. But I doubt he's going to be exactly at optimum sharpness if he's called upon at this point.
Has he played at all?
No, I've not seen him kick a ball.
I mean, that's all hypothetical, but that would be a big worry for me. I mean, Declan Gallagher has had a few issues throughout the season. If Kevin Holt is out for the remainder of the campaign, and I hope that's not the case, but if he is, you know, and there's going to be some huge games coming up. If one of the two centre-halves were to get injured, it would leave United with a real headache, I would think.
Just on the type of player and the type of game it's likely to be, Holt's the kind that in that sort of game where it's possibly not going to be a great passing move that wins it, but one piece of good football. Mm. Holt's got that in him. David Witherspoon, while he's obviously not fully match fit, if he can make the bench, he again could be an important addition to the squad on Saturday, couldn't he?
I think he's certainly been missed. He's a very calm footballer. He's
sorting the game down at Raith.
He's impactful in the final third. That's an exceptional point. He was probably the best player on the pitch at Stark's Park. I forgot all about that. It seems like a long time ago, but that was certainly Witherspoon's finest hour in a Dundee United jersey, and frankly, maybe he wasn't ready to complete 90 minutes, but the decision to take him off remains one that still baffles me to this day, because he didn't look tired on that day. But that's by the by. If he's able to, I'd be surprised if he was to come in after 4 weeks out especially with a muscular issue, and play and start the match. But if he has 20 minutes in him to be impactful and to do something in the final third to carve open Raith Rovers. If that's the flow of the game, then I think he could be an exceptionally valuable player.
Maybe
to have
even come on and keep everyone calm, keep the ball and maintain a lead.
Well, the thing that you would suggest, I mean, obviously, it'd be wonderful to think, sit here and think, do you know what? Dundee United are going to right all the wrongs of their previous games against Raith Rovers and win 3-0. And there's nothing in the previous meetings between the sides that makes you think that that is in any way possible.
Still be alive in injury time.
I think as well, you look at the games that Raith have won, it's took a spectacular goal in the last minute from Scott Brown. It's took a wonder goal from Dylan Easton, I've got to say, at Tannadice. A goal well above championship level that's done a moment of magic. And you know, it could be the same again, but United have got to believe that their moment of magic is going to be their turn. You know, it's going to be a Louis Moult or a Tony Watt moment of magic is going to turn this game on Saturday. It's going to be really tight.
Yeah, I think every bit of evidence suggests that it'll go to the wire again. You could barely slip a bit of paper between these sides in every contest. So if you've got someone like David Wotherspoon that can change the game off the bench, then that's a real positive because... glancing at the bench just at the weekend, there's some talented boys on there, but there's not many of them that are absolutely firing at the moment, whereas you would bring on a David Wotherspoon and know for a fact that this is a guy who loves a big occasion, loves the feeling of, you know, being involved in a game and doing a moment that can live long.
So. I'm also with Tom, and the fact is if you're winning the game and there's 15 minutes to go, you get him on the park and you just give him the ball. Give him the ball.
These throw players are valuable.
Give him the ball.
Just talked about
Luke to find him every time with the ball, and he keeps it. He wins free kicks. He kills the game for you. You know, and that's another side to David Wotherspoon. You know, so yeah, he's a good weapon to have, certainly.
And finally, and briefly, certificate of effort for the week. Does it go to Ian Murray for trying to Fergie style get in your head with a United have maybe cut the ticket allocation because they're worried and they're running scared or whatever.
Ian Murray seems such a polite guy to calmly spoken guy. I don't think that's in his makeup, is it? Is he a bit different? Alan, you know him better than us, obviously.
I remember
he seemed to do it quite politely.
He'll smile as he knifes you. No, he's every interaction I've ever had with Ian Murray, he's been an absolute gentleman and was always one of these guys, and we'll all in this room know people that are very useful for that. For if you needed a talking head on a Hibs story, he would always pick up his phone and you could get former Hibs legend Ian Murray insists, and then that's you filled the paper for another day. So he was always good for that. And
which the definition of a legend in that context, and I'm sure he is a genuine Hibs legend anyway, is the person that answers the phone's a legend.
Absolutely. The man that's willing to discuss the topic of the day is a legend, or at worst a hero. But this is a man who, what did he shave? 7-0 into the back of his head to reference a derby or something. He did something, or he shaved something in his head to reference an Edinburgh derby. So this is a man who likes
Scatchell. It's a very Edinburgh thingy, Scatchell. When he came to United for his brief spell, Scatchell got the number 51 because it was 5-1. They seem to love that week. We all go for a few pints after the game, and by the next week we've forgotten, never mind the next derby or the next decade.
But nevertheless, that does tell you that Ian Murray likes a wee spicy rivalry behind this.
It did occur to me that sometimes it's the honest reaction that can cut a thing dead, because Jim Goodwin seemed to go, eh?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah. I've got to say as well, Ian Murray comes across as a young manager, but he's an experienced
manager.
I was just thinking there, Tom, the day Dundee won the title at Dens under Hartley, they beat Dumbarton, that's all goes as that was 10 years ago.
2014,
Ian Murray was a Dumbarton manager that day, a very young man. So, you know,
Jack Ross, his assistant.
He served his time, so, you know, he's a very, very shrewd manager, and you've seen that with what he's done with Raith Rovers this season. And maybe he's just learning that.
Well, I think the one thing you can say is how his team handles it, time will tell, but you already know he won't bottle it.
He
won't be overly nervous about what's to come.
And Raith Rovers are doing what Raith Rovers do. They've been doing this all season, just the odd wind-up with social media. They're happy to be bombastic. They're happy to be disruptors. That's the role that they're playing in this.
And they do it with a smile, don't they?
And Dundee United are trying to be in their mind they are trying to be the bigger team. They didn't want to say anything about, for example, the ticket issue, which is why in the end, when Luigi Capuano finally did get poked enough by Andy Barrowman and Ian Murray to say something, it was a bit vague because they don't. I don't think they want to give every technical detail to do with their stadium out, but wanted to make it clear that we're not reducing tickets due to a level of pettiness. It's because, as he used the word several times, operationally, the shed is not in a position to accommodate the full amount of fans that were last time. So although people were pleading confusion and saying, I don't understand, what does that even mean? Pretty clear to me that something has changed with the stand from the last time they played at Tannadice to now. And I'm sure whatever that will be remedied over the summer. But there's a degree of silliness going on that Raith Rovers have leaned into all season, and Dundee United have been a little bit more... po-faced seems harsh, but I can't think of another way to put it. They've been a little bit more straight-laced about the whole thing, so it makes for a fun dynamic, but that all shuts up at this weekend and it's about who wins the football match.
I'd say the Raith fans who can't get tickets is, at least you're no queuing for the bridge with these roadworks.